So tonight is all about the future. It's about inspiration. And you know, in this time of really bleak headlines about climate change, Costa Rica is really an inspiration. Since President Alvarado announced plans to decarbonize the economy in March, dozens of countries have followed. So my first question is, how do you do it? How does a small country like yours inspire others to take action on climate?
Well, thank you all, and thank you, Justin. I believe we need to be consistent with action. Costa Rica comes from a legacy that about 61 years ago, we abolished the army. Also, 70 years ago, we established a model that allows us to currently have 99% of our electricity being clean and renewable, which is quite a base to trigger further development to tackle climate change. Also, we managed to enforce a forest system that for the past 50 years, we have managed to recover our forest coverage, going from 20% to now almost 50% of forest coverage, which is a nature-based solution. So being consistent with action allows us now also to take that action into a next level. And that's what the decarbonization plan is all about, taking action to tackle climate change to a next level.
Right. Well, I don't know how many of you have been to Costa Rica, but from my time there, it's one of the things I remember is the roads, the challenging roads to get through. You have to use a bus, or people use motorcycles. You've mentioned, you know, you've decarbonized the electric grid, but the roads, transport is much more difficult. How are you going to do that?
Well, there lies the great opportunity. Having a electric grid that's 99% clean and renewable, we can plug it into transportation and have a quick shift from fossil fuels to electric vehicles or hybrid or even hydrogen-driven vehicles. So that's a great opportunity to start lowering our carbon footprint and using renewables, still creating jobs and having innovation in the economy. For example, we're going to build two electric trains, given that our plug into this matrix, those trains will be absolutely clean. And also, this will benefit from the environment and for health people. This is going to produce more jobs as well. So it's a win-win-win scenario, and that's why we're going that direction. Also because it's an ethical decision. If there's a threat for our planet, then it's ethical to take action and to tackle that.
One of the way that opposition to climate measures is often framed is about trade-offs. People say, how do you, why address climate when, you know, you have housing shortage or healthcare to take care of? But you've spoken, I mean, you just spoke about why that's not the case, why you can't think of it that way. How do you make the case to skeptical Costa Ricans who might, you know, hear you talking about climate change here, but think, you know, why aren't you dealing with, you know, a housing shortage?
Yeah, or employment. Lots of people succumb with that. They say, why are you talking so much about climate change? Our needs have to do with agriculture, or have to do with migration, or have to do with jobs in the immediate. My first approach is listen. Because within those realities of people and their problems are the true keys touching climate change. For example, in the rural areas, the crisis of jobs and agriculture, it's very related with drought and with flooding, which is highly correlated with climate change. So when you explain that to people, they start saying, okay, so we also need to address that. And then to protect jobs as well. So the mindset is like reset. And people start thinking about my close reality of my community, how can I address it and change it, but also tackling a larger reality, which is the global reality of the climate crisis.
Right. I'm curious, you are, in addition, you're obviously a politician, a successful politician, but you are a novelist and a former journalist. How do you think about the work that you do in forming the narrative around climate change, right? We noticed that people are talking about, say, you know, being carbon free differently than they might have been a year ago since you've made your announcement. How do you think about that question?
Well, in the case of climate change, science is very important. But when you think about it, a discussion about, for example, 1.5 degrees, that's not heart inspiring. That's not talking to the heart. So when I talk about climate change, I relate a lot, for example, with my son, because he's 6 years old, and he's going to live in that world. That, I mean, it might be very tough to live in that world. So I want to provoke change now, so I can look at him at the eye and say, I did the best, and actually we managed to not having this problem for your future. So that's an inspiration for me. It's the one I love. I mean, it's my kid. And also thinking about my grandparents, they had a legacy. They gave us a legacy in Costa Rica, no army, universal healthcare, clean renewable energies. And that was a generation that most of them, none of my grandparents, finished grade school. But that generation managed to build that system. So it's coherent for me to, and responsible as well, taking that legacy and taking it up to a next level. So that's very inspiring. So, so I'm providing a narrative that gives passion. I believe it's a step closer for change to happen.
Right. You mentioned some of the things that came in generations past. You know, can you talk a bit about laying the groundwork for what you're doing now? I mean, what needed to come to help you come before where you are now to help you do what you are doing now?
Well, the work of people that were before us is very important because set the ground for us being the ones leading away on climate change. There are lots of ways, but we need to be together in order to make this change to happen. But it's also triggered on me the idea that it's not only about one generation and one lifetime. I mean, we received a great legacy. And we're thinking not only on our generation, but on the ones to come. I mean, this generation is the generation probably the most, that has the most strong responsibility in the history of humanity, basically in our hands. So there's a Chinese saying that the best time to plant a tree was 20 years ago. So that moment actually is now. Taking action now is going to make a difference for the ones to come. And when you think in terms of generations, then it leads us to action.
Costa Rica is playing a key role in the international climate talks. I'm curious if you could tell us, you know, a bit about what you expect to come and, you know, how are you trying to leverage your authority to shape that conversation for the better?
We're trying to have a conversation that's more integral, more holistic. In what sense? Climate change is related to poverty. It's related to inequality. It's relating to topics about gender. It's related to topics about human rights. I mean, it's a broad discussion we're having as a world. I used to have a minister when I was minister in the cabinet. I was minister of social affairs. He was minister of housing. And he said, you know, reality is really complex. But whenever we talk about something, you see poverty and I see housing. But people have broad realities. So instead of thinking of our own silos, let's think integrated about our whole problems so we have broader solutions to them and bring more people to the discussion. So that's the approach that Costa Rica is bringing to the discussion.
Is there a program that does that? Just, you know, one example that people might take home that is an example of integrating those different concerns.
Well, during the pre-COP that was held in Costa Rica past October, we exercised having those broad discussions, bringing, for example, inclusion, gender, and inequality in the climate change. For example, the land, the discussion about land. In Costa Rica, more than 80% of land is owned by men. So it's pretty unequal in terms of gender. So that's a topic, but it's also very correlated, as I mentioned, in agriculture and climate change, and very correlated with poverty and job creation, and then migration. Migration in Central America is a great driver for migrations from Central America is lack of jobs in the fields, highly correlated with climate change. So if we tackle climate change and build prosperity in those communities, I mean, we're fostering the future for the whole region. And that's the aim we should take, cooperation, making lives better for people all around the neighborhood.
Absolutely. Well, thank you so much for doing this. Such a great, so glad to have you here.
Thank you. My pleasure. Thank you.